I gotta say, it's so damn good to be back here at the Newport.
Okay, ready? Let's go. Whoa!
So as far as rock clubs in history, it's not only the longest continually running rock club, but it's becoming one of the most famous.
Ohio! 2, 3, 4.
If the world ends, you know, this place will still be here. And that, you know, that gives me strength. I hate when you go back and it's an old condemned and, you know, boarded up and stuff. And I hope that never happens here.
In a social climate often characterized by ongoing unrest, economic decline, and political opposition, one truth surpasses status, age, race, and gender: the love for live music. Since the dawn of the live music scene in the 1950s, fans have flocked to venues throughout the country just to catch a glimpse of their favorite band. Through that process, a litany of now historic live music venues and legendary rock clubs were born. National treasures like CBGB's, the Fillmore East and West, the Troubadour, and Whiskey A Go-Go, to name a few. Only one, however, can lay stake to the claim of longest continually running rock club in the country: the Newport Music Hall in Columbus, Ohio. You got me down on the floor. Originally built in 1923 as a movie theater, the venue resides in the heart of the Ohio State University campus at 1722 North High Street. In 1970, it was turned into the Agora Theater by owner Hank LeConte and began to host live music. The list of acts that have come through the Agora are nothing short of iconic, many of which can now be found in the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. Bands like AC/DC, Queen, Rush, Alice Cooper, Pink Floyd, The Grateful Dead, U2, B.B. King, James Brown, Ted Nugent, Iggy Pop, Buddy Guy, The Police, The Charlie Daniels Band, Talking Heads, Meatloaf, and Kiss, just to name a few. The Agora nearly met its demise in 1984 when it was rescued by now legendary concert promoter Scott Steinecker and renamed as the Newport Music Hall. Rock and Roll Hall of Famer Neil Young played the inaugural show at the Newport, and the list of acts that have followed have continued to be historic. Bands like Fall Out Boy, Green Day, Pearl Jam, OAR, Nine Inch Nails, 21 Pilots, Garbage, Snoop Dogg, The Flaming Lips, Red Hot Chili Peppers, Queens of the Stone Age, Foo Fighters, and the list goes on and on. Without the vision of Hank LeConte and Scott Steinecker, none of it would have been possible.
The Newport Music Hall, when you first see it, it's an old theater built in 1923.
The marquee coming off, hanging out over High Street, and it looks like an old vaudeville house. It's part of the block. It's like Wrigley Field in Chicago is part of the neighborhood. The Newport is part of the block.
It's got that raw rock club feel. You're not afraid to spill a beer. You can let loose, and that's the success of the Newport Music Hall.
It's not the biggest of halls, but it's that provides the intimacy that a lot of artists enjoy when they're there.
And I love this place because there's an intimacy you can't get playing the big places.
It was so different. You walked in and you had the little palm trees. Are palm trees still down there?
Yes, uh-huh, we got palm trees.
And that was about the only thing different. A lot of the other stuff wasn't in, and it was clean. Mm-hmm. And that flipped people out right off the bat.
Yeah.
And people were nice to you when you came in.
Yeah.
And that flipped people out.
Yeah.
And it was such a feeling. And you know what, man? Not only was it Neil Young, but it was just a feeling that, yeah, this is, you know, an old, like something that, you know, near and dear to me, this is like an old friend has been rehabbed, you know? So it's the same old friend, but brighter and better and happier.
What Hank means to Columbus is that Agora Building, which is now the Newport Music Hall, became a centerpiece for the rock and roll industry. Everybody in the industry has gone through, whether you're an artist or a tour manager or a production manager, through the old Agora in Columbus, Ohio. It's a famous rock club to anybody who's in the industry. So by Hank opening that and starting that, has put Columbus, Ohio kind of on the rock and roll map.
This place here goes back to silent movies. Remember, this was built in 1922 or 3. It was voted by the by Columbia Records and by other record companies that this was the number one showcase club in the country.
I was manager of a band when I went to Ohio State, and the attorney that I worked with called me and said, hey, they're going to shut down the old Agora. You ought to see if you could save it.
You know, when the Agora dynasty started to crumble, I think Scott saw it as like already a great space that was set up, looks great with 800 people, and you know, you can't slide a piece of paper between the hips and the elbows if there's 1,600, and there have been 1,600 people in there before.
He got me the number of the LeConte family in Cleveland. I called, asked for Hank LeConte. He was the legendary promoter of that, of all the Agoras. There were 12 Agoras at that point. And I got Nick, his brother, and I explained that I wanted to be able to lease it, and they're like, no, it's gonna be a Walgreens. We already have a deal almost in place. I said, well, let me talk to Hank because I think he would want to keep it as a live venue. So he gets on the phone. He goes, all right, Scott, if you can get me $25,000 by the end of this week, we'll lease you the building. So I scrambled that week to raise $25,000, and I flew down to Dallas, Texas, met Hank LeConte, and we struck the deal. The key was I was able to wire $25,000 back for Hank LeConte.
He saw it. I mean, it's a jewel. I mean, it sits across the street from the world's largest university with thousands of music-hungry kids and young adults. It was a perfect salvation or find for him to go back and resuscitate.
It stayed a rock club without a name. It wasn't until 1984 when I flew back from New York City. The guy who had sat on the pep board with me at Ohio State, Joe Brooks. Our desk was one of the Newport round tables. They're still there. And there was only one light that worked in the whole building. It was in front of the bar. So we sat around that one round table and had people come in and we talked to them, and we didn't have a name. Going to lunch one day, we walked over to the Ohio Union, talking about what are we gonna name it. We were laying out all the different things, and well, it's new, we want a new place, we want a new port for music. It was two words originally, but then we combined it to Newport Music Hall and Rock Club.
I think I actually met Scott in the main atrium at the Newport Music Hall, like his first or second year of business. I was kind of shocked that here was this seemingly younger guy than me that was now owning this club that I used to spend many a night at, both as an employee and as a music fan while a student at Ohio State. It's kind of funny.
After 50 years of live music, the Newport has cemented its place in the pantheon of the greatest live music venues of all time. During the five decades of legendary artists and performances, there have been countless memories. Take a journey with us as we put our ear to the walls of the house that rock and roll built and discover what we might hear if these walls could talk.
Could be sweeter than with you.
In the streets we wanna
AC/DC came and performed, band from Australia, they were just making it big, played, I believe it was a Sunday night, and from the stage announced, hey, we're sticking around tomorrow. If anybody wants to buy tickets, we're gonna sell them after the show. And literally the second show, the very next night, sold out that night.
If you think about that kind of intensity and that kind of power, but packed into a much smaller space, and I think you get an idea what that Newport experience is all about.
Ted Nugent's played that building forever. The very first national artist to play the building was Ted Nugent back in May of 1970, I believe. And he's continued to play that building ever since. He's been playing it for 30-some years.
Ted likes playing the Newport because there's no noise regulations that affect him at our local outdoor arena. And so, my ears were bleeding that night.
I ain't even warmed up yet.
We brought him back for our 20th anniversary. And we always heard about Ted's the loudest act over here. He said, Scott, go get your sound man for me. We walked in the dressing room, Ted's back was to us. He was tuning his guitar.
Okay.
He turned around, stuck the butt of his guitar right in our sound man's face, and said, do you have any relatives that live here in Columbus? And Tim goes, yes. He goes, if you don't turn it up as loud as it'll go, I'll hunt him down and kill him. And he turned back around and kept tuning. And Tim was like white.
There is a certain spontaneous combustion that takes place when you're in a room that has a reputation, but the reputation isn't just this flitting concept in the night. It really is based on the human contact with this building. And I'd like to think that Columbus is a suburb of Ted's world anyhow, because I've got a real connection here. I really believe in this working hard, playing hard commando network in the heartland of America. And I've been playing here since I invented rock and roll back in the 50s. I want substance over symbolism. I want something I can grab onto. I want something that enhances my level of awareness. I want something that enthuses my spiritual connection with whether it's the bow and arrow, my child, the air around me, or that guitar.
How about the time Melissa Etheridge had to deal with a guitar going bad on her?
Oh, that's a great story.
She was a favorite there, and I think she was on stage the night the power went out.
And I think it was just stage power. Instead of her walking off stage, she picked up her acoustic guitar and played Mercedes-Benz by Janis Joplin.
Won't you buy me a Mercedes-Benz? Oh, Lord, won't you buy me a color TV? Dialing $4 is trying to find me.
She and I've produced her show every time she's been to Columbus since. I've brought her to town probably a dozen times. She always, during her set, will play Mercedes-Benz acoustically and talk about that night at the Newport Music Hall.
I wrote this song about Columbus, and I figured it's important to play it.
It would have been the third, fourth, and fifth grade. I went to Crestview School, and I think it's still there. And I lived out on Summit Street. Those are some of the greatest memories of growing up. You know, those were the days before I really discovered women, you know. That was that one naive and innocent summer when you played Kick the Can, you know? And I wrote a song called Indian Summer, actually, which is on, but seriously, folks, which is the one where I'm underwater, and it's called Indian Summer. And that was about that one summer.
I'm still at the fishing hole.
But I love this place because there's an intimacy you can't get playing the big places. and everybody has a good seat. The balcony is really fun. I mean, if I had my choice, I'd be up in the balcony.
And you know it ain't as easy as it used to be. Finding time to let my mind wander.
It's important that some of us old timers keep going to show younger musicians that you can realize peace and enjoy the benefits of success and still have some brain cells left.
I mean, to be honest, I've played here so many times that to say which was the first time as me, it probably sort of cross-collateralized with Humble Pie, if you know what I mean. So, played here a lot.
I have a story on Todd, and I think it's a story that he will never forget. The night before Todd Rundgren, one of his road people came in, and he wanted to show me how good he was, and he wanted to clean up all our gear, so he completely tore our board down, took all our amps off the racks, and stripped all our stuff down, ready for cleaning and repairing, and he had it all over the floor. The next day, Todd Rundgren comes in, and here's everything all stripped, our board is stripped, everything. Todd Rundgren stayed up all night and put our entire system back together again.
Okay, ready, let's go, whoa!
B.B. King used to play every year almost, well, every other year.
The first time we played him during the vacation. It was like 2 weeks before Christmas. And because we used to gear it towards the local Columbus audience.
At one time, from where I came from, it was almost against the law for whites to even listen to the types of music that I play. And when guys like the Beatles, Elvis Presley, and many of the people that was doing rock and roll came on the scene, this opened up a lot of doors for me, I know. I can speak for B.B. King. But you're gonna have a few, you know, that's kind of like Lucille, that ain't gonna never want to do nothing, right?
He played the Gods when they first surfaced. That was like in the, I'm gonna say that they probably formed somewhere around 74.
The actual night that the Gods got a record deal, we got a record deal at that club. We'd never been in a studio before, ever. The show that sticks out in my mind the most, and probably always will be Kiss opening for Rory Gallagher. And I mean, you couldn't have two more mismatched acts. The lights went out during the show. There were like tornadoes that night, and there was a big thunderstorm out, and the lights in the club went out. And Gene Simmons still had his candelabra on the stage with real candles on it. It's when they were real primitive then. They're still in leather and things, and he handed candles out to the audience for people to see.
I am a tourist in your sunny day, like a babysitter. When I see your dog smile, I cry inside a little, cause it's just so.
In addition to the countless legendary acts that have played the Agora, now Newport, the venue has meant a great deal to the city of Columbus and the up-and-coming artists that reside here. Without the presence of the Newport and PromoWest Productions, much of the vibrant live music, arts, and entertainment culture that the city now holds dear to their hearts would be absent.
We were born with walking shoes.
For many of the new artists residing in Columbus, throughout Ohio, and in the Midwest, the Newport represents the crown jewel of achievement to set foot on the same stage as so many historic acts. Part of what PromoWest does, a concept completely unique to their company and vision of owner Scott Steinecker, is build bands up through their family of venues as they increase their fan base and graduate to larger capacity stages. Many now famous musicians have gotten their start here in Columbus, Ohio, and their time within the confines of the Newport have paid immense dividends towards the advancement of their now flourishing careers.
I mean, OAR started out, they would play for fraternities, and we brought them to the Newport, and they had a band called Red Wanting Blue as the act with them. Not really the opener, but the act with them. OAR would always close. So we got it to the point where 500 people, 800 people, 1,000 people, sell out. So I finally met with the two bands and said, why don't we do each of you on a night? Let's see who's really drawing the crowd. And at that point, it was OAR. Now, Red Wanting Blue themselves now can sell out the Newport Music Hall. But at that point, it was OAR was more of the strength. OAR went on to have the bigger career, but now Red Wanting Blue is starting to blossom their career. So both those bands, you know, have come through the system.
They were the first big company that ever gave us a chance. You know, when we were young and just out of college and were looking for some place to play that was larger than a small bar, this place took a chance and said, you know, hey, you can come in here and start playing. So us and other young bands in the area and that were around OSU and Columbus started putting together bills because nobody could fill it on their own. But when, you know, you put a few bands together, you'd start putting these Columbus bills together. And that's how we got started playing in here. And we never, ever let them close the door on us. So we just continue to keep going. And fortunately, we've had more people keep coming. And that was at least 23 shows ago.
Jonas Brothers played the Basement. I mean, there's a lot of bands who have played the Basement or the Newport. Just about probably every act in the industry has played the Newport. And if you go back and look at the old Agora days and the old Newport days, there's not an act from Pink Floyd to the Grateful Dead to Tom Petty opened for Meatloaf. You know, everybody has played that level. Bruce Springsteen, U2 for $4.50. You know, every act has come through the Newport.
Yeah, we've had many record label deals over the years, and when we deal with the big-time booking agencies and all that stuff, it has become very sterile and corporate feeling. And dealing with Scott, you know, he's really, he loves the local music scene, and he supports it, and it's having access to someone like that where you can go sit down and talk about doing a show together is really neat.
Columbus for us was the beginning of who we are now. It really shaped us into who we are as individuals, but also as a band. And I think when people think of Ohio around the rest of the world and the United States, they don't really know exactly what to think. But we feel like we, you know, have something to prove coming from Ohio, and we're really proud of where we're from. And hopefully we make them proud as well.
I can feel your breath. I can feel my
sipping whiskey by the river, living so damn right. 100 miles an hour in a fast lane.
What the Newport means to the city of Columbus and the live music industry in general is in many ways immeasurable. For a rock club to withstand the test of time and span across 5 decades is unheard of. Hence the title, the longest continually running rock club in the country. The careers that have been launched, the stories that have been shared, and the lives that have been impacted are vast. These walls are built on the foundation of rock and roll history and persevere through its iconic allure, all the while continuing to host some of the greatest artists in music today.
I think Newport Music Hall means longevity and stability to the music industry. There are not a lot of venues that can say that they've been doing this for over 50 years now at this point. It's a staple when you come to Ohio as a band, as a touring musician, you need to play Newport.
Where it all began, I started my career here. The company started here, and I think a lot of bands started their career right here in the Newport Music Hall.
One of my most memorable moments at the Newport I wasn't even working here. I was actually just attending a concert. It was an Edward Sharp and the Magnetic Zeros concert. And the show had finished and they'd already done their encore and everybody was heading out. And I think I knew a couple people that worked here at the time. So I was kind of one of the last 50 people in the crowd. And when their production team was cleaning up the gear and all that, the band came back out on stage and kind of put on another few songs for the remaining people in the building. So they had us all sit down and there was probably 50 of us and they played a third encore, but only for a select few people. And that's just one of the memories that sticks out for me. It was just super special. It was like you're catching magic in a bottle.
Show I've ever seen at the Newport Music Hall, I'd probably say James Brown. But there's so many. I mean, Robert Palmer did his thing, or the band came and played, or we caught the Ramones selling tickets out back. The Ramones shows were awesome. Just so many. But if I had to pick one, either Neil Young, the grand opening night, maybe 21 pilots when they came back to do a tour of Columbus. They're probably James Brown.
Thank you.
world continues to change and new platforms for music and media consumption increase, the Newport stands tall. These walls, this venue, represent more than live music history. They are the foundation of a city and its culture. They are the pillars to an industry that inspires and captivates us. They are legend to the artists who pass through them. They remind us why we love coming together, and most importantly, why we love music. Because the Newport Music Hall, like all great forms of art and expression, is truly timeless.
The Newport, what it means to me is opportunity. I came down here during freshman orientation, as many folks do, through the tour and things, and you know, I met actually our singer, Mark Roberge. I met him at freshman orientation at Ohio State. So we had gone through the day's classes or whatever we had to do that day, and then ended up running around together on High Street. So I remember vividly walking down High Street, heading south towards downtown, And looking at that marquee and just thinking to myself, you know, what if one day I can do something that would put me on that stage? And funny enough, you know, it would be with Mark, which neither one of us knew that at the time. So, you know, it just, to me, it was just kind of this, you know, special thing where, one, I met this guy that ended up, you know, we ended up chasing our dreams together, and we walked past and commented on the spot where we would really kind of start off a lot of those dreams, and it would be the catalyst for us to go out there and get after it, you know, with our lives. So Newport's definitely a special one for us.
Newport is turning 50. I think it's interesting to think about how many people actually got their start here. Not just the bands, but also the audio techs, the lighting techs, stagehands, promoter reps, marketing and sponsorship, even security and bar personnel that have worked here. There's just so many people that can say that this was their first gig, because Newport is that perfect mid-level club that allows you to learn from the ground up. On day one, you might walk in here and learn how to plug in a mic for the first time. And within a year or two, if you work hard and play your cards right, you could end up walking out with a national tour.
Slayer played here each year, the first 3 years I worked here. And I don't remember which show it was exactly, but one of the ones, they were moshing in the pit, and there was a person in the balcony who jumped off of the balcony into the mosh pit, and the crowd cleared out of the way, and he hit the floor. So working security then, we jumped over the barricade and made sure he was okay, and he was, luckily. And then we threw him out the side door.
Started in 1973. It was the Agora Ballroom, and I believe I worked the Humble Pie show. And I'll never forget that night. I graduated from high school in 72, year out of high school, And it was my first show working there. And then I worked some more in the 70s. And then in 1984, 85, Scott Steinecker bought the Agora Ballroom and turned it into the Newport Music Hall. And he brought me on board. And I'll never forget that night. It was Neil Young.
Give me one more chance.